You're very welcome to this act of worship, which has been prepared for Sunday, the 7th of February, 2021. In the past week, as a nation, we have been reflecting upon the life of the late Captain Sir Tom Moore, and many people have been giving thanks for his fundraising efforts and his ability to raise our sense of well-being during this time of pandemic. And it is fitting that Captain Tom's efforts are recognised, but as he himself would no doubt have said, his efforts were motivated by the desire to serve others. And we need to recognise that as a people we are blessed in our own community with many who seek to serve and bless others, just as Captain Tom did. So let us give thanks not just for the life of Captain Tom Moore, but for all of those who give so much of themselves to serve us, and let us honour them in word and in deed. In our worship today, we meet in our homes rather than face to face or in person. But we come to worship a God who loves us, who cares for us, and who wants to be known to us and wants to be known by us. So let's come into his presence and let us rejoice and give thanks for all the blessings that he has bestowed upon us. And as we do that, we turn to our call to worship. And today we're using some of the verses from Psalm 147. And we begin at verse 1. And read through to verse 7. Praise the Lord! How good it is to sing praise to our God! How pleasant and fitting to praise Him! The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars and calls each of them by name. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. The Lord sustains the humble, but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with grateful praise. Make music to our God on the harp. And with the thoughts of praising our God, we turn to our opening song this morning. And it is one by Chris Tomlin, entitled Forever. And after we have sung that piece, Ruth will come and lead us in our opening prayers.
Above all things, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. Sing praise,
Let us pray. Creator God, as we gather to worship you in our homes, we thank you for your endless goodness to us. Although we have not been able to meet as a church family yet in 2021, we are grateful for technology which allows us to come together although we are apart. As we see the signs of spring in our gardens, we are reminded of this new season of hope and optimism which we are moving towards. Even in the midst of the coronavirus pandemic, we can see everything is in your control and everything will be fulfilled in your perfect timing. The new life springing up around us in creation is a reminder of the new life we can have through faith in Christ Jesus. Grant us strength to overcome the fears we have about the future and empower us when we appear to lack faith. All of this we pray in your precious name. Amen. Now let us join together as we say the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
We say thank you to Ruth for leading us in our prayers. Can you remember back to the days before COVID-19 and the restrictions that are currently in place, when we could meet in person and terms like social distancing and face coverings were not to the forefront of our minds, when we could meet with friends for coffee and have long in-person face-to-face chats, we could even invite them round to our homes without having to think about social bubbles, etc. I'm sure you can recall those days, and we trust and pray that those times of face-to-face meetings, in-person gatherings, will be part of our future in the not-too-distant future, and they'll become part of our ordinary lives once more. This morning, I would ask you to think back as to how you might have spent your Sunday afternoons after you had been to a service of worship in the morning, perhaps. What did you do? Did you head home or to the home of a friend, or perhaps even go out together to share a meal, to share in fellowship around a table? Eating a meal is something that we are used to doing either in company or alone, and it is part of our ordinary day life. And in our first reading today, we'll hear about an ordinary part of a day and what people had been doing after they had been to worship in the Sabbath. You may well recall that last week we spoke about Jesus in the synagogue in Capernaum on a Sabbath morning, and how he taught with authority and with a word of command drove out evil spirits. But after they left that place of worship, and as they were returning to the home of Simon Peter, I wonder what was going on in their minds and what the day was to be like. Was it just going back to be an ordinary Sabbath once more? We'll find out what happens as David reads for us. And when he has read for us, we'll sing, O Christ the Healer, we have come.
Reading from Mark chapter 1, verses 29 to 34. Jesus heals many. As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they immediately told Jesus about her. So he went up to her, took her hand, and helped her up. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. That evening, after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door. and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but he would not let the demons speak because he knew who they are. Ending the reading in verse 34.
We say thank you to David for reading for us. And he will be back to read for us another short portion of scripture in a few moments. As Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they would have walked together to the home of Andrew and Simon Peter. And the very ordinary events of the day seemed to be returning. But I wonder, as Jesus and the disciples walked to that home, did the disciples begin to talk among themselves about what they had witnessed, what they had heard during their time in the synagogue? Or might they have just been so amazed at the words and the deeds of Jesus that they walked almost in a stunned silence? Or perhaps they were asking themselves the question, who is this man whose company we're in, who has called us to follow him, the amazing things he has done, the authority with which he speaks? And now they were walking to a home to share a meal together. To the home of Simon Peter. We know from the details that Simon Peter was married because we're told that it was his mother-in-law who was ill. And that little piece of information makes me think of the orderliness of life that they were entering into. You had a number of generations living together in one home. You had Simon Peter, potentially a family, and his mother-in-law, his in-laws dwelling there. And it was just an ordinary home, an ordinary family, doing an ordinary thing, sharing a meal together. In our culture, the idea of multi-generational families living in one home is not as common as it used to be. But in those days, in that time, it was quite common to have multi-generational families all living together. And for Jesus and the other disciples to be invited into the home to share a meal together. But we're told that his mother-in-law, Peter's mother-in-law, was ill. And when Jesus became aware of the lady's condition, he acted, he moved to bring healing to her body. We're told that he went and took her by the hand, and immediately she was restored to the extent that she could get up and wait upon them. Jesus' healing of this lady was not motivated by his desire for a meal, but rather to restore her to health. And that he did simply with a touch. I wonder once again, were those disciples who had been in the synagogue with him amazed at what had happened? An extraordinary event, one who had been ill, raised to such an extent that she could wait upon them just by a touch from Jesus. When the meal came to an end, I wondered if the people in that household begin to talk together and think and reflect upon the healing of Peter's mother-in-law, and then put that together with the healing that took place in the synagogue, the driving out of the evil spirit, the teaching with authority. And they began to talk together. No doubt they did, and no doubt the events of the synagogue earlier in the day had spread throughout the town as well. So we hear that as evening fell, as sunset came, the whole town, the whole population of Capernaum seemed to be standing outside the door. And that little fact that it was after sunset that the people gathered should not go unrecognized. You see, the situation was such that it was held that healing and the driving out of evil spirits was classed as work, and that should not be done on the Sabbath day. You may recall how Jesus healed a crippled woman on the Sabbath. It's recorded for us in Luke 13 and verse 14. How the synagogue ruler reacted to that. Indignant because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, the synagogue leader said to the people, "There are 6 days for work, so come and be healed on those days and not on the Sabbath." But here in Capernaum, the Sabbath was officially over, so people would have felt free to come and seek a healing touch, a word of teaching from Jesus. The demand for healing was great, and the population of the town seemed to be there, and Jesus responded. And we read that he healed many and drove out evil spirits, but he would not let the spirits speak. We should not be shocked when we read that Jesus healed many. Doesn't say that he healed everyone, because later on in Mark's Gospel, we read that when he was in his own hometown of Nazareth, he was unable to do many miracles because of the unbelief of the people there. It's in Mark 6, and reading from verses 4, 5 and 6 here, Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honour, except in his own town, among his own relatives, and in his own house. He could not do any miracles there, except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them." He was amazed at their lack of faith. Jesus in Capernaum healed many. In his own hometown, he was unable to heal many, due to a lack of faith of the people around him. We live in a culture where few people believe that our God can heal and can restore people to health in this day and age. And I wonder, is it a case that unbelief hinders the movement of God? But that should not be a case among his people. We should believe, and we need to believe, that he can move to turn ordinary days into extraordinary days. That Sabbath day, that ordinary day, was now over, but Jesus, by authoritative teaching, by healing, with a spoken word or a touch, had turned it into an extraordinary day, which impacted upon the lives of many people in the synagogue, in the home of Simon Peter, and indeed in the town of Capernaum. To hear what happens next, David will come and read for us once again.
Mark chapter 1, verses 35 to 39. Jesus prays in a solitary place. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him, and when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That is why I have come." So he travelled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out the demons. Ending the reading at verse 39.
We say thank you to David for reading for us. In the passage that he read there, we're told that it was very early the next morning, while it was still dark, that Jesus got up and went to a solitary place where he prayed. Jesus' earthly ministry was being shaped and formed by how he taught, the way in which he healed, and people were beginning to ask questions about him. They were beginning to wonder, could this really be? Could this man from Nazareth really be the Holy One of God? Could he be that long-awaited promised Messiah? If Jesus was aware of those conversations and people saying those things, it didn't inflate his ego. It didn't make him self-reliant or self-sufficient. Rather, he was willing to take time, and he wanted to take time, to be alone with his Heavenly Father, to spend time in his Heavenly Father's company. I wonder, as a people, do we find enough time to be alone in prayer with God? Or do we cut short our times of prayer due to the pressures of a busy lifestyle? Because if Jesus, the Son of God, who performed miracles on a daily basis, needed to pray, needed to spend time with his Father, should we, those who proclaim to be his followers today, not also seek to spend time in the company of our Heavenly Father? Jesus had wanted to be alone with his Heavenly Father, but Simon Peter came looking for him. And the reason Simon Peter came looking for him was that the people, everyone, was looking for Jesus. Everyone wanted more from him. Clearly, the people of Capernaum had taken notice, and they'd experienced the healings, they'd experienced the teachings, and they wanted more of Jesus. Did they just want to receive the physical blessings? Do we just want Jesus for the physical blessings? But notice what Jesus said. He knew that his time was limited, and he did not want to confine himself to one location. So he said he wanted to go to another town, to another location, so that he might preach there. And in those locations, he could turn ordinary days into extraordinary days for other people, those whom he would meet with along the way. Ordinary days. I wonder, as you sit there, are you beginning to think of some of the ordinary things you're wanting to do in the rest of this day? Perhaps thinking about a meal. Perhaps thinking about what you can do, allowing for the restrictions under which we live. But I wonder, are you prepared to have your ordinary day transformed into an extraordinary day? Because that Jesus who went to the home of Simon Peter and healed his mother-in-law with a touch, who taught with authority, who healed many and drove out evil spirits, that living Lord Jesus wants to meet with you today, wants you to come into his presence, wants to have the opportunity to take an ordinary day and make it an extraordinary day for you, to transform your life, to change your life by being in his presence. In lockdown, we're not as busy as we maybe sometimes were. Let's take this time to draw close to Jesus, to rest in his presence, and to find just how much he wants to be in our company and to bless us and to minister to us if we will just believe. We come before our Lord in prayer as Elma leads us in our prayers of intercession.
In 2 Chronicles chapter 6, we read, "The Lord appeared to Solomon at night and said, 'If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land.'" Let us pray. Our Father God, thank you that you have taught us how to pray in the words of Jesus, and you have taught us to call you Father. We have instant connection as your children, and we are thankful. Your word reminds us to pray continually, and so we bring our requests, our prayers of intercession before you with confidence. Our Father, we come today aware that our land is indeed in need of healing, physically and spiritually. Some of us have lost friends to COVID, and we are conscious of many who remain seriously ill in hospital. We remember those known and unknown and ask that they may know your healing touch. We ask too for those working at the cutting edge of the pandemic, in hospitals and nursing homes, the ambulance service, the nurses and doctors, those who clean our hospitals, the porters, all putting their lives at risk. May they know your protection. Our prayers are offered for those who take decisions in government. We can but accept those decisions on trust, and we ask our Father that your mighty hand can intervene to bring wise counsel and stable outcomes into difficult and sometimes confused circumstances. We ask especially for your protection, our Father, on Robin Swan. We pray against any negative reporting and ask that he will know your continual strength and calm as he carries out his work. We were created to be in community and not in isolation. Show each one of us ways to connect with one another. Help us, our Father, to be the body of Christ in different ways, and most of all, where you have placed us. Some of us are more proficient in the use of technology than others, but thank you that we can meet through the use of IT to pray and to worship. Help us to become more familiar with the use of technology and to share this with others. Enable us, our Father, to appreciate each other more and to value the small things. We have so much for which to be thankful. A roof over our heads, a clean bed, more food than we need, and family and friends who care. Be with those who have no such blessings, and there are many, sometimes due to their own foolishness and often through circumstances beyond their control. Be with those who work in the food bank, and we remember Peter, and all those who support the project in different ways. We think too of Gordon and those working with CAP. May they know your blessing and wisdom as they counsel and advise. We bring before you those working in education, from primary through secondary and on to university level. We remember Ruth, with responsibility for younger children, finding new ways to communicate and encourage learning. Enable our Father, parents who struggle to homeschool their children, often without the support mechanisms within a classroom. This has been such a difficult time, and we pray against the gaps in education, which we trust will not have implications for the future. We again bring the ongoing concerns for our circuit and friends, those known to us who need your healing, your reassurance, and your comfort. We bring before you, our God, Sandra, May, who remains in hospital, Thelma, Nan, Pat, Isabel and John, the Sherrod family, the Daly family. Help them along with those not mentioned to be still and to know that you are God. For our ministry team, we give thanks and ask for your continued blessing and protection. For Tommy and Dawn, for Lee and Maeve, for Norman and Linda. We remember too our local preachers and all who hold office across the circuit. We pray also for the Surf Project, for wisdom, as they consider what they can or cannot do in this new season. And in the words of Scripture, yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendour. For everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Wealth and honour come from you. You are ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise your glorious name. Amen.
We say thank you to Elma for leading us in our prayers of intercession. Now we will turn and sing our closing hymn, "And Can It Be That I Should Gain an Interest in the Saviour's Blood?"
And can it be that I should gain an
That you were able to join in the singing of "And Can It Be?" And as we prepare to part and to go about the rest of our ordinary days, let us bless one another with the words of the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.